Turn with me to Acts chapter 4, and thank you for allowing me to be here. I just really appreciate the Pattersons. I appreciate this seminary. I got to see an old neighbor that we were together here 30-plus years ago, Guy and Elena Key. It was so good to see them. And they have been missionaries in Brazil for many years. We lived next door to each other. And if you live at 4021 Sandage, let me know. I'd like to meet you before I leave, because that's where I used to live 37 years ago. While I was here, I learned so many things at the seminary. But one thing that I learned from a man that was a preacher in this area, and he went all over the world telling people about prayer, his name was Don Miller. If you go back up to the corner of this building, right up the way that I'm pointing on the second floor, you'll see the prayer room. It's the Don and Libby Miller prayer room. And I was literally captivated with the concept of prayer. I don't consider myself by any means an expert on prayer. The only expert on prayer is the Lord Jesus. But I will tell you this, that everything you need, God has. And everything God wants to do with you and through you, He will do it as you pray. Prayer is not a little addendum. It's not something attached to your ministry. Prayer is the very spout of your ministry. It's the very beginning of your ministry. And if you don't pray, you will miss what God wants you to experience. And so I want to talk to you about this early church. I have been preaching at Bellevue through the book of Acts. It's one of the most fun times I've ever had in my life. I'm 59 years old, been preaching a long time. First time I ever preached at Southwestern Seminary was in about this time in 1984 in senior preaching chapel. And I remember I preached on 1 Peter chapter 5 on how to be a pastor. I'd been one for a year, so I knew all about it. Amen? And Guy actually read the scripture that day when I did that. But at any rate, I don't know that much about being a pastor now. I've been doing it for a long time. But I will tell you this, that God wants you to pray. And how in the world did that early church go from Jerusalem to Rome in 30 years? How did that happen? I believe one of the secrets is that they prayed. So let me just talk with you just for a little while about when God's people pray. And I won't read the entire text and then go through it. I'll just walk through it as we begin in Acts chapter 4, beginning at verse 23. Acts chapter 4, verse 23. The first thing that we see is this: when God's people pray, they overcome persecution. They overcome persecution. Look at verse 23 in Acts chapter 4. When they had been released, who is they and what had they been released from? Well, they, talking about Peter and John, they had gone to the place of prayer at the time of prayer at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And simultaneously, God had set a beggar there. He was on his way. It's kind of an unusual time for a beggar to be showing up. He should have been showing up earlier in the morning, but for whatever reason, he was showing up at the prayer time in the afternoon. And aren't you aware of the fact that when God is up to something, He's working on both ends? He's working on the person through whom He's going to do the miracle, and He's working on the one who's going to receive the miracle. And so this man is brought there and laid there at the beautiful gate. And the Bible says that Peter, by the Holy Spirit, knew that God wanted to do something in this man's life. So he said, "Look at us." And the man looked at him, thought he was going to get a lot of money, but he got something greater than money. Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And the Bible says, then Peter stuck out his hand. You're talking about an act of faith. He stuck out his hand and he said, "Now get up." And he got up. And the man stood up for the first time in his life. And standing wasn't enough. He had to walk a little bit. And walking wasn't enough. He had to leap a little bit. And don't you love it when people get saved and they don't know how to act at church? Amen? Yeah. He walked into the temple and he was walking and leaping and praising God. Everybody got excited. They said, that's the lame man. He's been healed. He comes out. They follow him out. The people are waiting out there with bated breath. They can't believe what's happened. And Peter said, oh, this is a great time to preach, just like the day of Pentecost. And he preaches, repent therefore and return, that your sins may be washed away, that times and seasons of refreshing may come to you from the presence of the Lord. And when that happened, all kinds of people got saved and everybody was happy, right? Wrong. Acts 4, the Sanhedrin, the Sadducees, that's a great name for them because they are sad, you see? And they lock them up because it's too late to try them that day, and they come out the next day and they persecute them. And they say, in what name and what authority have you done this? And Peter now, just as bold as he can be in Acts 4, verse 8 says, rulers and elders, if we are on trial for the benefit done to a sick man as to how he has been made well, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus the Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name this man stands before you in good health. And then Peter quoted Psalm 118 verse 22, a messianic text, Jesus is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. And then he lowered the boom in chapter 4, verse 12, and there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven, no other name in the universe that has been given among men by which we must be saved. And the Sanhedrin recognized these guys had confidence, freedom of speech. They said, we've seen this before. And it says in verse 13, they realized that they were uneducated, agrammatos. They were not schooled in grammar. They had not gone to the rabbinical schools, and they were untrained, idiotos. They were untrained idiots. Men, regular men, and they were amazed. Now watch, and they began to recognize that they had been with Jesus. I want to ask you something. Do people, when they look at you, say, he has been with Jesus? When they look at you, ma'am, do they say, she has been with Jesus? There's something about the aroma of Jesus on them. When they come into a room, it just changes. When they leave a room, there's not chaos, but there's calmness. When they leave a room, there's the sense of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Is that what happens when you enter a room? Is that what happens when you leave a room? Are people better off than when you came in a room when you leave it? They said, we realize they have been with Jesus. We have not seen that kind of confidence. So you know what they did? They didn't know what to do. Guess what you do when you don't know what to do? You call executive session. You shut the door because you don't want anybody to see that you don't know what to do. And that's exactly why they put them out. And they decide, let's just warn them and release them. They did. When God's people pray, they overcome persecution. Now, I realize that there are people all over the world that are being martyred for their faith, and those people are, by the grace of God, overcoming persecution by going to the presence of Jesus. It's a win-win, man. If you get killed for Jesus, you overcome. If they let you loose, you tell more people about Jesus. Either way, God's going to be glorified. That's what happens when you pray. You overcome persecution. Number two, you enjoy unity when you pray. We could use a little bit of this in the Southern Baptist Convention, could we not? Look at verse 23. When they had been released, they went to their own companions. They reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they had heard this, they lifted their voices together to God with one accord. Verse 32, the congregation of those who believed were of one heart. They went to their own companions. They gathered together in unity with the body of Christ. They gave a report of what had happened with the Sanhedrin, and they all lifted their voices at the same time. They lifted their voices. Beautiful phrase of prayer. They lifted their voices, and the Bible says they were with one accord. Homothumadon, one accord, one purpose, one mind, one impulse. Congregation, verse 32. Plethos, it's where we get our word plethora, large number, multitude, crowd, assembly, fellowship. It was referring to the ecclesia, the church of those who believed. They were of one heart and one soul. That's what happens when you pray. You can't pray for somebody and with somebody and stay mad at them very long. You just can't do it. Because the Holy Ghost starts touching you and saying, you know what? You're just like them. I mean, what you see wrong in them, you've got your own spots, and they need to forgive you, and you need to forgive them. And you know what? You're not right over here. They may not be right over here, but I'll take care of that. You just let me handle that, God says. And all of a sudden, you have a desire for unity and not division. You know what division is? It's two visions. That's all it is. If we would stop having spiritual double vision and get our minds on Jesus, we'd have unity in our churches. No more disunity. No more division. One vision, and keep our eyes on Jesus. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Naught be else to me, save that thou art. Focus on Jesus. That's how we get it. And when we pray, we come together, and there's this beautiful, beautiful one heart and one soul, one mind. Oh, how we need this. I just want to encourage you. Be real careful. Don't be a smart aleck on social media. Don't do that. Well, I'm going to take advantage. I'm going to rebuke somebody on social media. Now, I'm not going to call them. I'm not going to talk to them directly because I don't have the guts to do that. Oh, but I'm going to rip them apart over here, and I've got my little echo chamber of my little 100 followers, and they're all going to say the same thing, and that will affirm me, and I'll know that I'm doing right. You know what? You're not going to answer to an echo chamber. You're going to answer to God. How about a little unity, sir? And I'll tell you where it starts, on your face and on your knees before a living God. That'll get you where you want to be with everybody else, even if they don't agree exactly with you on every little thing. Did it ever dawn on you, you might be wrong? Hello? Number three, when God's people pray, they don't just have unity, but they depend on Scripture. Look at verse 24. And when they had heard this, they lifted their voices to God with one accord, and they said, O Lord, it is you. That's a great way to start a prayer. O Lord, it is you. And then they start praying Scripture, one of my favorite things. You who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. That's Exodus 20, Nehemiah 9. Psalm 146, who by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said, and then they start praying Psalm 2, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples devise futile things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. They start praying and they depend on Scripture. They depend on Scripture when they preach. They depend on Scripture when they pray. You know, when you start talking to God, you need to pray the language of Scripture. And when you start talking about God, you'd better be talking the language of Scripture. When God's people gather, they claim the promises of God. They pray the Word of God, just like Jesus did on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? What's he doing? He's praying Psalm 22, verse 1. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. What's he saying? He's praying. He's praying Psalm 31, verse 5. They understood that when you pray the word of God, you're praying the will of God. When you pray the will of God, God hears, because the Bible says if we know that we have prayed, and I appreciate your prayer a moment ago, asking for the will of God to be done. That's the way our hearts ought to be. Lord, if we pray according to his will, 1 John 5 says, we know that he hears us, and if we know that he hears us, we know that we have what we've asked of him. So I want my prayers to be answered, so I need to be totally submissive to the will of God. And I've got to realize I can't always figure out the will of God, but I got a feeling that God knows the will of God. So I want to pray Scripture as much as possible. I pray for lost people. I've already prayed for lost people today. You say, what do you pray for them? And you say, I don't even think you should pray for them. Then don't ever read what Paul wrote in Romans 10:1. Brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer for them is that they might be saved. Yes, you're supposed to pray for lost people. What are you supposed to pray? How about John 16:8, that God will convict them of sin and righteousness and judgment? How about Romans 10, where it says, they shall call upon the name of the Lord and they shall be saved? How about what I just said a while ago, Acts 3:19, that they will repent and return, that their sins may be washed away, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord in their lives? I pray that for lost people every day. I witness for it to them too, but and then pray for them to have a contact. Pray for conviction, conversion, and a contact. That's what you pray for lost people every day. And if you don't have lost people you're praying for regularly, start praying for lost people. And then start praying for our country. We can use it. Pray for the President of the United States. Well, I didn't vote for him. Doesn't matter whether you voted for him or not. The Bible, you say, what can I pray? How about Proverbs 21, verse 1? The king's heart is like channels of water in the hands of the Lord. He'll turn it wherever he wishes. Start praying that for Donald Trump and for Mike Pence and all those people in Washington. Who would want to be the President of the United States nowadays? I mean, you, the minute you do it, everybody, one side's mad at you and everybody else is talking about you. Who would even want that? Start praying for him. Start praying for your church. What can I pray for my church? How about Acts 9:31? That your church will enjoy peace, be built up, go on in the fear of the Lord and the comfort of the Holy Spirit. They will continue to increase. Why don't you pray for America, by the way? And some people say, oh, that text in Chronicles, oh, that's not for us. You know what? It's for the people of God. And I do it every day. I say, Lord, from Maine, here's how I do my hand. Lord, from Maine to Florida to Texas to California to Washington to Minnesota back to Maine, I love this part, all across America. And I reach up there and grab Alaska and reach down there and grab Hawaii too. Lord, I pray that we, your people, called by your name, will humble ourselves, pray, seek your face, turn from our wicked ways. You will hear from heaven, forgive our sin, and heal our land. We need to be healed. We need to be touched. And if the people of God will get healed, the land can be healed. I'm not going to let anybody steal that promise from me because they said, oh, that was just a covenant promise to Israel. You know what? The Bible says that the Old Testament promises can be prayed. Jesus prayed them. Paul prayed them. Peter prayed them. Steve's going to pray them. Okay? If I get in trouble with God, I'll be glad to let him rebuke me on that. But I'm not worried about it. I'm not worried about that. They depend on Scripture when they pray. And when they pray, number four, they exude confidence, not cockiness, big difference, but confidence. Look at verse 27. For truly in this city they were gathered together, they're still praying, against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your purpose predestined to occur. They had been made bold through prayer. They were not arrogant. They were not egotistical. They were not condescending. They were not conceited. They were not smug. They were not cocky, but they were bold and confident and courageous in the Lord. And I want to tell you something. When you see somebody confident in Jesus, it is very attractive. Very attractive. When I see somebody cocky in their flesh, it is very, very ugly. But when I see somebody confident in Jesus, it is a beautiful thing. And these guys were confident in the Lord. They understood the truth of Psalm 31, verse 15. Lord, my times are in your hand. They were like little David when everybody else was running from Goliath. He was running to Goliath. Everybody else was saying he's too big to hit. He said he's too big to miss. And he ran up there with that little sling, and Goliath starts cussing at him, and he said, you come to me. David says, you come to me, big boy with the big boys. I just threw that in there. You come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord God of hosts, the God of Israel, whose armies you have taunted, and this day you're going down. I'm taking you down, and I'm taking that bunch behind you. After I whip you, I'm going to whip all of them too. Now listen. That all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. That's the kind of preachers we need. That's the kind of preachers you need to raise up here. People that will be bold in Jesus. Loving, compassionate prayer warriors, but bold in Jesus Christ. Oh, it's beautiful when they exude Christ-like confidence. Number five, when God's people pray, they offer strategic petitions. Your prayers all of a sudden get focused and they get real strategic. Look at verse 29. And now, Lord, we've told you the problem. We've praised you. We've told you the problem. Now, Lord, take note of their threats. Epaidon, fix your gaze upon, look at, concern yourself with. Write it down in your journal, Lord. That's what he's saying. Take note of their threats. Grant that your bondservants may speak your word with all confidence while you extend your hand to heal and signs and wonders take place through the name of your holy servant Jesus. First strategic petition, Lord, take note of their threats. Put it down in your eternal ledger, O Lord. Then second strategic petition, grant that your bondservants may speak your word with all confidence. And if you read verse 31, God answered precisely what they asked for. And then third strategic petition. While you extend your hand, they understood that they weren't healing anybody. It was the Lord that was healing people. They weren't casting any demons out. It was the Lord that was casting demons. That your hand may heal and signs and wonders take place through the name of your holy servant Jesus. To God be the glory, they were saying. They were offering strategic petitions. And if you look at the rest of the book of Acts, that's exactly what happened. God took care of their persecutors. God dealt with them. They continued to speak God's word with confidence, all confidence, and God's hand was still working, and people were being saved and healed and set free. They offered strategic petitions because they learned to pray. Number six, when God's people pray, they experience miracles. They experienced miracles. Look at verse 31. And when they had prayed together, the place where they had gathered together was shaken. Now, commentaries just fall all over themselves. Well, it wasn't a literal shaking. Well, they weren't there. They don't know. They just don't want it to be a literal shaking. I think God, who made the heavens and the earth, could shake a little old bitty room. Don't you think that? What's the big deal with that? You say, why do you believe it shook? Because it said it shook. Who am I to say it didn't? And who are you? You can have as many degrees as a thermometer, but you can't tell me that thing didn't shake. That thing shook. God shook it. It was no big deal to God. Well, why didn't it fall in? I don't know, and you don't either. It just shook. If God can shake it, he can hold it together while he's shaking it. God was just like, I said, hey, boys, I heard you. I got it, boys. It's all right. Now, some of y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Why would God want to shake it? Well, same reason I like to shake my little grandbabies. I could walk in the door, Papa! And they run up, and I grab them, and I just go, that's all I do, right? No, man, I grab them, I go, rah! I shake them. Why? Because I love them. I love them. And you say, that's the craziest exegesis I've ever heard in my life. I thought this was a textual seminar. Well, you better be careful. Because the Lord, the Father, loved it when his son died on the cross so much he shook the place. Matthew 27:51, behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Herschel Hobbes said, from top to bottom, not from bottom to top, but from top to bottom. God tore it, man didn't tear it. And the earth shook, and the rocks split. I got news for you. God can shake anything he wants to whenever he wants to. That's God's way of saying, I'm pleased. They experienced miracles. And a lot of people say, well, those don't happen anymore. Now's not the day of miracles. I don't believe in a day of miracles. I believe in a God of miracles. I'm a satisfied customer when it comes to God changing somebody. Then when they pray, number seven, you say, how many are there? I know, don't worry about it. They share the gospel. When God's people pray, they share the gospel. Look at verse 31. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak the word of God with boldness. They had prayed for that, had they not? Confidence, boldness, they got it. And with great power, megale dunamai, great power, mega power, the apostles were giving testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. I got to lead somebody to the Lord a couple of weeks ago. If you'll just be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, God brings lost people to church. I walk out of Guest Central, met all those people back there after the second service. I'd been there since 6 o'clock in the morning. It was about 1 o'clock, 12:45. Guy and Elena, she was from Brazil, Estella. And I walked back there, and she's sitting with some people. And I went over there, felt like the Lord. You say, how do you know that was the Lord? The devil didn't tell me to go talk to him. And my flesh sure didn't, Brother Jimmy, because my feet were hurting. You know that feeling, don't you? By the way, my mother-in-law had fixed me a pecan pie and some chicken at the house. So I had every reason not to go, all right? But the Spirit of God laid on my heart to go. And so I went over there, and sure enough, started talking. Now listen, she's dating, you can't make this stuff up, an Elvis impersonator from Australia. We get every Elvis impersonator from all over the world, man. We get them. They come to Memphis, all right? Name was Jack. I start sharing the gospel. Make a long story short, Estella got saved right there. Got saved right there after church. And I'd already given the invitation, and I give an invitation. Brother Matt, you don't have to wonder how to get saved after I give an invitation. I tell them how to get saved, tell them to get saved here right now, and tell them we'll help them get saved right now. We'll help you lead, come to Jesus right here. We do it all the time. And when I talk to the girl, she still says, I just didn't know what to do. That shows you right there that preaching is wonderful, invitations are great, but soul winning, individual soul winning is where a lot more people are going to get saved. Dr. Fish used to say, You can't serve Jesus with a zipped lip. Chuck Kelly says, if Jesus is in your heart, he's going to come out of your mouth. Charles Spurgeon said, if sinners will be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our bodies. If they will perish, let them perish with our arms about their knees, imploring them to stay. If hell must be filled, at least let hell be filled in the teeth of our exertions, and let no one go to hell unwarned and unprayed for. When God's people pray, they share the gospel. When God's people pray, they enjoy bountiful grace. Number 8, bountiful grace. Look at verse 33, an abundant grace. Charis te megale, they was upon them all. Mega grace. You don't just need grace for salvation. You need grace for sanctification. You come to Christ, you're saved by grace. You mature in Christ, you grow in grace. Salvation is all of grace from beginning to end. Abundant mega grace was upon all the children of God. Dark is the stain that we cannot hide. What can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide, whiter than snow you may be today. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. When God's people pray, they enjoy bountiful grace. I don't want just a little grace, I want mega grace. Number 9, when God's people pray, they become exceptionally generous. Not an amen in the bunch. One, Verse 32. And not one of them claimed that anything belonging to him was his own, but all things were common property to them. Verse 34. For there was not a needy person among them, for all who were owners of land or houses would sell them and bring the proceeds of the sales and lay them at the apostles' feet, and they would be distributed to each as any one had need. This is not an example of first century communism or socialism. No one was being forced to relinquish the right of property or possessions. Rather, the Holy Spirit was prompting them, saying, if you've got two shirts, just like Jesus, or just like John the Baptist said, if you've got two shirts, I read this morning in my quiet time, if you've got two shirts, give somebody else one. If you've got two meals, give somebody else one. If you've got something, your brother and I have something, help them out. And they took that literally. And rather than the Holy Spirit was prompting them with exceptional generosity. I just want to say this to you. You can't follow somebody who gave his life on a cross and not be a giver. You can't follow a God who gave his only begotten Son to the world. You can't follow that God without being a giver. You can't follow the Holy Spirit who gives us peace and the presence of God and the spiritual gifts. You can't follow the Holy Ghost and not be a giver. Every time you are prompted to give, it is a prompting from the Holy Spirit. And I tell you what I have to do, Doctor. I have to do it real quick before I talk myself out of it. When God prompts me to give, I carry a little cash with me. And by the way, you don't have to be wealthy to be generous. You just have to be obedient. I've been doing this since I worked at Piggly Wiggly here in Fort Worth, going to seminary. Just carry a little cash with you, and it will shock you how the Holy Spirit will just whisper gently. He just talks gently, just gently. Give them something. Give them something. And you know it's the Lord, because the devil didn't tell you to give them something. And if I get to heaven and God says, Gaines, you gave too much, I can handle that. I don't think I'm going to have to worry about that. My selfishness doesn't want me to give. But you're never more like Jesus, doctor, than when you give. And these people were not, this is not communism. This is not socialism. This is Jesusism. The one who gave his life just prompted him and said, look, give to them. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. The word hilarious, that's the word. You know what should happen? We say, it's time for the offering. Our whole church ought to go, yes, the offering. Praise the Lord. Come on, let's go. I want to give, I want to give, I want to give. You say, you've lost your mind, pastor. You've lost your mind. No. It's a lot better to give than to receive. Isn't it? It's all like Monopoly anyway. It all goes back in the box. There's no rich people and poor people in heaven. There's just people in heaven. I love what you guys put on the little magazine that you send out. Mike, great job on that. I saw that. Don't be the richest person in the graveyard. Be a giver. Be a giver. Because when God's people pray, they become generous. Proverbs 22, verse 20, verse 9. He who is generous will be blessed, for he gives some of his food to the poor. Last point, when God's people pray, some become gifted leaders. Ah, Barnabas, good to see you, sir. Verse 36, now Joseph, a Levite of Cyprian birth, who was also called Barnabas by the apostles, which translated means son of encouragement, and who owned a tract of land, sold it and brought it, the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. What a leader he became. You know, when we want a leader, we hire a headhunter. When they wanted a leader, they got on their face before God and cried out and said, God, give us leaders. And God raised them up. Barnabas, how are you going to get better than that? He was with Paul and other three prophets when God called them to missions. Missions was birthed in a prayer meeting, not just the church, but missions was birthed in a prayer meeting. Acts 13. Barnabas helped mentor the Apostle Paul, who wrote half the New Testament. Barnabas would also pick up John Mark when Paul was ready to throw him away. John Mark wrote the first gospel. Matthew and Luke used that to help write their gospels. I tell you what, where would we be without Barnabas? God just raised him up. Out of the church, just raised him up. Every worker you need in your church is there if you'll just pray. Every worker you need. So how about it? I know I sound like a broken record, but I told the Lord, I didn't want to do this Southern Baptist Convention thing. I didn't want to do the presidency. I didn't want to do it. I'm not trying to be a smart aleck. I'm not trying to sound cool. I'm just telling you, if anybody knows me, they know I didn't want to do it. I did not want to do it. Not because I don't love the Southern Baptist Convention. It's just not my kind of thing. It's just not my deal. But how many of you know that the Lord sometimes says, it doesn't matter if it's your deal or not, it's my deal. How many of you know he does that to you sometimes? And I'm telling you, as clear as a bell, God called me to put my name out there to do it. And so I won the minute I said I'd do it. I'm not talking about I won the election. I'm just saying I won if I lost, because the Lord laid on my heart to do it. But the Lord told me the whole time, every time, he said, now when you go, you tell them I want them to pray. I want to say this to you. I don't know who you are, but I'm telling you, God Almighty wants to talk with you. God Almighty wants to talk with you. That's more important than the president. That's more important than anybody on this planet. God wants, not just daily, sometimes hourly, God just wants to walk with you and talk with you. If Don Miller was here, I know what he'd say. Teach me to pray, Lord. Teach me to pray. This is my heart cry day unto day. I long to know thy will and thy way. Teach me to pray, Lord. Teach me to pray. Living in thee, Lord, and thou in me. Constant abiding, this is my plea. Grant me thy power, boundless and free. Power with men and power with thee. Teach us to pray, Lord. Let's pray that together. Teach us to pray, Lord. Let's all pray it. Teach us to pray, Lord, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Amen.